Hello, everyone. So today's topic is going to be on the Haskalah. We're going to talk about a movement that's extremely important for the development of modern Jewish identity, something that I'm especially interested in this course. But let's get right to it, because this is an essential lecture, and we want to try and boil everything down to the most concrete points possible. So first of all, what is the Haskalah? This is a Hebrew term. It's derived from the Hebrew root sachal or sechel, meaning intelligence, and it is a translation of the German term Aufklärung, which means enlightenment. This is a movement that the Enlightenment, that is, that spread across Europe about 50 to 100 years prior to the Haskalah, and Jews really picked up on it and translated it into Jewish terms. And it has some specific elements which are really particularly appropriate for the Jewish community that distinguish it from the Enlightenment as a whole. In the generality, however, the Enlightenment was a reference to a greater emphasis on reason as a source of truth rather than religion, for example. So there's a decline of religion in the Enlightenment, more emphasis on science, more emphasis on popular sovereignty, ideas of democracy, things like that. America is very much a child of the Enlightenment. And we'll see how it expresses itself in Jewish culture. I'll point out just now in passing, and then we'll have a slide where we look at in detail, the Haskalah is expressed very differently in Western Europe than it is in Eastern Europe. That is, the Jews who became maskilim, that is, those who adhere to the Haskalah, really took different things between West and East, as we shall see momentarily. The Haskalah is especially associated with this man, Moses Mendelssohn, a rather amazing individual who lived in the 18th century. And although he himself was strictly observant, he somehow managed to cross the barrier to become quite famous in general German society of the time. Known as the Illui, the genius of Berlin, he attracted a wide following primarily of liberal non-Jews and aspiring maskilim, that is, Jews who wish to penetrate the larger culture of Germany, with his ideas. He was an extremely controversial figure in many quarters. His translation of the Chumash into German was received with great applause from many Jews in the West, who felt that it was finally an opportunity for Jews to apprehend German thinking properly, because here they had a text that was in Hebrew that allowed them to really experience proper vernacular German, whereas Jews in the East felt that it was a tremendous transgression to use the Hebrew text in this manner, that it would open up the floodgates of assimilation. And in fact, none of Mendelssohn's grandchildren were Jewish. All of them ended up converting to Christianity in one form or another, and in fact, his commentary was burned. Nevertheless, he is sort of like the central figure in pushing forward the Haskalah, and even though he himself maintained that strictly observant lifestyle, his followers in the second and third generation of his intellectual inheritors were not able to retain that that sensibility, as we shall see if you look at some of the longer lectures. So what's very important about the Haskalah politically, as opposed to intellectually, is the fact that it was related very closely to the concept of emancipation. Emancipation was a term that later Jewish historians borrowed from American culture, somewhat inappropriately. Obviously, if you study American history, you're familiar with the Emancipation Proclamation, the freedom of the African-American slaves, and Jews wanted to kind of hijack this term, in English language at any rate, hijack this term to refer to the granting of equal rights to Jews in Europe. Now, the Jews were not slaves in Eastern Europe, but they were subject to a large variety of disabilities. They were considered non-citizens. Generally, they were resident aliens. And they had to endure all kinds of ritual humiliations, like, for example, appearing in the town square once a year, where the mayor of the town would slap the chief of the Jewish community across the face, and all kinds of strange things like that. You know, discriminatory taxation and economic discrimination, various types of privileges were revoked or were not granted. For example, this is a picture of the Jew's Oath, which is a 17th and earlier century phenomenon. Since Jews were considered broadly untrustworthy, should a Jew be required to present himself in court, in a secular court, his oath was considered invalid unless he went through a ritual humiliation to indicate that, you know, he really did mean what he was saying. And Jews would, of course, strive to avoid this kind of humiliation. As you can see from the picture, he's got his shirt bared, his head is uncovered, he's made to stand barefoot on a pigskin and lay his hand on a Hebrew Bible before he takes his oath. So there are all kinds of these discriminatory impositions on Jews. All kinds of higher access to education was closed to them. Many professions were closed to them. And so Jews in Western Europe in particular really wanted to be emancipated and to be granted the kind of freedoms that would allow them to express themselves politically, economically, socially, culturally, and so on. They finally got their chance in 1791, 2 years after the French Revolution, in which, with the toppling of the king, France suddenly became a dramatically transformed democracy. And as you can see in this poster from the period, here are French citizens saying the indivisible unity of the Republic, in which they proclaim liberty, equality, and brotherhood, or death. So if it meant liberty, equality, and brotherhood, then that surely must include the Jews. Now, when this came before the newly formed French Parliament, they hesitated a little bit, but by 1791, they had determined that, in fact, yes, the Jewish inhabitants of France were also to be considered French, and they were to be given equal rights. A tremendous milestone in the history of Jewish civilization, and as we shall see, it had a tremendous ripple effect throughout Europe. Of special interest is Napoleon's Sanhedrin. So, as I mentioned, in 1791, the Jews were given equal rights, but within a decade, there were a lot of complaints from non-Jews, particularly in the Alsace-Lorraine region bordering on Germany, saying that the Jews had taken these rights and had used them in an exploitative and unfair manner to oppress their non-Jews that they had come into competition with. Obviously, this is an aspect of economic competition because Jews were suddenly allowed into various professions and into various economic activities that had previously been closed to them, and a lot of markets shifted as a result, so there was a certain amount of pushback on emancipation. Napoleon thought about the question, and ultimately he took a very bold, characteristically bold act. He summoned a Sanhedrin, meaning he tried to reestablish the grand court of the Jews that had not existed for 2,000 years. The two millennia separating ancient Israel and 18th century or 19th century France did not bother Napoleon, and he in fact convened a large body of Jews, which involved Jews of various stripes. At this time you had a lot of Maskilim who were very much promoting the proposal, and so Napoleon put 12 basic questions to the Sanhedrin, asking the Jews to put it, to kind of summarize it into one question, you know, what's going to be with you Jews? Are you going to consider yourselves members of another nation who are temporarily residing in France, which is historically how Jews would have regarded themselves. They're part of it, the Jewish people, a kind of tribal biological relationship, and they anticipated an eventual return to Zion under a Messiah. Or, said Napoleon, will you consider yourselves loyal members of the French nation, expressing a Mosaic persuasion, but nevertheless loyal to France, fighting against its enemies, upholding its laws, etc., etc. The Jews of the Assembly of Notables, which was later expanded to form the Sanhedrin the Sanhedrin under Napoleon, answered with a thunderous yes. In fact, they said when they were asked if they would defend France against its enemies, which was a very subtle question, you know, would you fight against Jews who were from Germany if you were in war with them? They responded, jusqu'à la mort, to the point of death, meaning that the Jews would really buy into this. Napoleon accepted the answer and therefore confirmed the emancipation. He added a few anti-Semitic discriminatory laws to try and reduce the competition, but that's a little bit more detailed than we need here. This great picture here shows, you know, it's a state picture that Napoleon commissioned, so it portrays him in the light that he wanted. And you can see here he is holding up the the Ten Commandments. It says la loi, the law, meaning the Ten Commandments of the law in his right hand. And on his right, there are several Christian prelates who are demanding that Napoleon not extend, you know, equal rights to the fallen Judaism. That's the woman who is there, and he's reaching out his hand to pick her up. She's holding on to the Ten Commandments as well, you can see there. And in the background, you have the Judean desert, the menorah, and so on. Napoleon obviously viewed himself in a kind of neo-messianic fashion here as being someone who would ultimately, you know, transform the world by rescuing the Jews, among other things. So the whole idea of the Haskalah in Western Europe was really tied to this idea of emancipation, that the Jews would somehow gain equal political rights if only they behaved appropriately, if only they met the required questions of people like Napoleon with the right answers. Now in France, it happened suddenly, all at one shot, basically, and then a little bit of a hiccup under Napoleon. But in Germany, it was a difficult, drawn-out process that took most of the 19th century. And as a result, German Haskalah expressed itself rather differently. So let's look at the distinctions primarily between how the Haskalah expressed itself in the West and in the East. So in the West, and now we're talking primarily countries like Germany in particular, France as well, England, to a certain degree, major cities and places like Hungary. The Jews there were reaching for this goal of emancipation. They believed that if only they would, you know, meet the requests of the dominant nation, if only the German government would see that Jews are really loyal citizens, then they would be emancipated and everything would be wonderful. In the East, in the Russian Empire, there was no such thought that perhaps the Jews would gain equal rights. In fact, the Russian culture did not hold for most Jews the same kind of attraction that German culture in particular did for Western Jews. And so rather than striving for, you know, accommodation to the state, there was more of a rumbling of revolution. In the West, in a somewhat apish manner, the Jews often tried to adopt German norms, with, you know, tremendous changes to long-hallowed religious traditions and customs and so on in order to try to appear more German. And that led to a tremendous degree of assimilation, as we shall see. In the East, the Haskalah was not expressed in a pro-Russian assimilation. Rather, it was expressed in a rather revolutionary fashion, either through socialism, which again represented a desire to do away with the Russian government, although it may have been expressed entirely in Russian language and tradition. The idea was fundamentally revolutionary rather than assimilationist, or Zionism. The bulk of the Zionist movement, although its leaders hailed from Western Europe, where they had a lot more freedom of movement and a lot more freedom of activity, in Eastern Europe, there was a great yearning for Zion, which represented a challenge to the status quo in many ways, as we shall discuss, God willing, in another lecture. In the West, there was a huge emphasis on Jews learning the vernacular, that is, learning German, being able to communicate effectively in the language of the country, to observe its civic duties, to serve in the army, pay appropriate number of taxes, and so on and so forth. In the East, there was a certain amount of desire to improve the ability of Jews to speak Russian. By the way, in the East, the vast majority, well into the 90s, 90 percentiles, vast majority of Jews spoke Yiddish as their mother tongue, which is essentially a version of medieval German written in Hebrew characters with a huge influx of Hebrew, Aramaic, Romance, and Slavic words as well. As Billy Crystal put it, Yiddish is basically German with phlegm. That's a joke. I can't hear you laughing, but I hope you are. Anyways, but more significant in the East, the language question for Maskilim was resolved in favor of Hebrew. Those, of course, were the Zionists who believed in the revival of this ancient language that had become moribund. It was not spoken at that point. Or the affirmation of Yiddish, which was not considered a bona fide language. It was considered a bona fide language. It was considered a jargon or a kind of a the Jewish language. It was not considered really a full-fledged language. So many people in the 19th century said, no, this is in fact the authentic voice of the people. Let us create a literature in Yiddish. Let us affirm Yiddish. Let us standardize its punctuation and its spelling and so on. So that's how the language question formed up. In the West, there was some significant liberal support. That is, the idea of Jews attaining emancipation was a cause celebre among many individuals. Lessing, for example, and others really believed that the time had come for Jews to be freed. In the East, you didn't have the same kind of significant figures in the Russian leadership who felt that Jews should also achieve this goal. And finally, in the West, you have a level of denominationalism, where in their attempt to articulate an identity that was at once both Jewish and German, you have these new formulations of traditional Judaism that challenge the status quo very significantly. In the East, you don't have a nearly as large a phenomenon. In the large cities like in Warsaw, in Lviv or Lvov, you might have, let's say, a Reformed temple, but the vast majority remained Orthodox, even if they were rejecting Orthodoxy. The movement they were rejecting was Orthodoxy. They did not really get attracted to an alternate movement. Let's look at those liberal movements now. So, two very significant ones. The first is the liberal movement per se, which is known in America as the Reform Movement. This is a grassroots movement that really got started in the first decade of the 19th century, and it's often associated with the work of this man, the scholar Abraham Geiger, who identified a real need among German Jews to express themselves in a way that they felt spiritually meaningful. They were alienated by Hebrew. There was a large-scale ignorance of the language and its meaning. They were put off by the arcane and rather oriental forms of worship with the long talit and the mixed seating between men and women, the kind of chaotic service, and so on. And they felt that, you know, they wanted to really emulate more Protestant German norms in their form of worship. So there are a lot of innovations that Abraham Geiger and the Reform movement in general brought about that were considered anathema by the traditionalist opinion. That included, for example, the introduction of church bells into the synagogue. On Saturdays, of course, that was considered a violation of the Sabbath. The removal of the mechitza, separating the men's and women's section. Removal of certain passages, for example, the idea of messianism was very problematic to the whole goal of emancipation. If the Jews were ultimately waiting to go back to Zion, to Israel, then what did that mean about their homeland here in Germany? And so therefore, messianic references in the liturgy, which are rampant, were removed. And things like the term synagogue was changed to the term temple. Synagogue implies temporary, it means literally a gathering place. It's a translation in Greek of the Hebrew term Beit Knesset, whereas temple, Beit HaMikdash, implies permanence, singularity, and so on. So by changing the name from synagogue to temple, it meant we're going to stay here, this is our temple here in Berlin or Hamburg or whatever. But it was the Hebrew language that caused a major split in the 1840s when at a Reform convention, they voted to remove Hebrew from the liturgy entirely. And of course, the movement has gone back and forth on many of these issues. But Zacharias Frankel, shown here, who was present at that convention, said, that's it, it's too much. The pace of change of this liberal movement, the Reform movement, was simply too fast for him. He felt that it was moving willy-nilly, and it was kind of pushed by the demands of the population rather than by a rabbinic leadership standing out front and determining the pace of change and the nature of change. So he formed a movement which was called at that time the Historical Positivist Movement, which agreed in principle with the appropriateness of changing Jewish practice, but disagreed with the Reform movement in terms of the process of change. He emphasized much more of a leadership of rabbis who were learned, who would express themselves and issue written opinions, teshuvot, really, to try to articulate the direction and the pace of change. And this eventually became known in the American world as the conservative movement. So these two movements were considered anathema by the so-called Altglauberin, the old believers, who took on the term Orthodox. It was originally a term of opprobrium, meaning one doctrine, or straight doctrine. And this was considered by those who hurled this term at the traditionalists to be a kind of a sense of being close-minded and blinkered. But the Orthodox ultimately took that term and said, yes, we agree. We believe there's basically one way to worship God. Of course, there are many different strands within that one way. It's not monolithic, but they held to the inviolability of things like the Torah coming from Sinai in its entirety, and the 613 mitzvot as being eternally valid, etc., etc. So let's look at the Orthodox reaction to these movements. So there were two basic reactions, very different in character. The first is exemplified by the writings of the Chatam Sofer, a very important Hungarian rabbi, who felt that reform, either in its liberal form or in its conservative form, was represented and challenged a very existence to Judaism, and had to be rejected completely, pushed away with both hands. He coined a term which is kind of hard to explain in a minute, but maybe I'll try. There's this law that has to do with the consumption of wheat that is grown after a certain date before a certain sacrifice will be offered in the temple. This wheat was called chadash, or new. It was new wheat. And there's a debate in the Talmud, on what level is it forbidden? Is it forbidden by the Torah, or is it forbidden by the rabbis? So the Talmud concludes, chadash asur min haTorah, which is understood in its context to mean the new wheat is forbidden by the Torah. The Chatam Sofer took that whole phrase and he translated it literally, chadash asur min haTorah, meaning whatever is new is forbidden by the Torah. And this represented a kind of, it's a little bit of a joke and a pun as well, but this represented a concept of saying, no, we are under such tremendous stress right now as a people that any change represents a potential breach that could widen to destroy the walls that retain our identity, and therefore everything that is new, modern, must be rejected. There's a lot to talk about how exactly do you apply this principle, but this is ultimately expressed in certain forms of Orthodoxy today, which have an extreme allergy to anything new, whether it's technological, sociological, or so on, and view chadash asur min haTorah, and everything new has to be approached as if it were highly toxic, and that perhaps it was quite dangerous to the well-being of the Jewish people. Another approach, which is more characteristic of Central Germany, is the one evinced by Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch. Now, the Chatam Sofer's approach would work very well in an environment where the vast majority of Jews already essentially believe in the Torah coming from Sinai and the inviolability of the inviolable, I'm not sure what the right word is here, and the permanence of the value of the 613 mitzvot. But Rav Hirsch was working in an entirely different environment where the vast majority of Jews are actually leaving. They're already voting with their feet and they're moving to these new liberal environments. The dam has already burst, and Rav Hirsch had to find a way to try and articulate a safe space where he could at least retain a core population that would ultimately grow to a much larger movement. And so he coined a term. Well, actually, I'm not sure if he coined the term, but the movement was named after him, Neo-Orthodoxy, or as it's translated often in America, Modern Orthodoxy. And the basic concept was that, let's look very carefully at our practices. Let us determine which practices are mandated by the Torah, and we will absolutely, without compromise, adhere to those principles and behaviors. On the other hand, those other things which are merely accretions of fashion, style over the centuries, if they are, external to the essential aspects of Judaism, we can simply abandon them. So elements like trimming one's beard in an appropriate manner, or wearing clothes that are appropriate for 19th century Germany, attending university, all kinds of things like this, which are not so clearly forbidden by the Torah. And of course, there are discussions about all of these things. But, you know, those things could be adopted. And so he tried to articulate a kind of an interesting balance between modernity on the one hand and traditionalist orthodoxy at the other hand. This movement eventually coalesced into the something called Torah im Derech Eretz, meaning Torah with the way of the land. It's a paraphrase or a quotation from Pirkei Avot, and it's expressed in the modern Orthodox movement in America today. However, as part of this strategy, Rav Hirsch also articulated the Austritt, which means the separation. And it was a very controversial thing that occurred in the 1860s in Germany, where he appealed to the German government, the Austrian government actually, and said, you know, I'm not sure whether it was Austrian or German, but oh well, maybe I should edit these things. And too late, let's just keep going. He appealed to the authorities, and it was a very unprecedented appeal, to actually split the Jewish community in two. Traditionally, each municipality was governed by a single Jewish body. You had a parnas, a president for the entire body, the kehillah, as we discussed in a previous lecture. But under Rav Hirsch, he said, look, it is impossible for us to have one community when you have a large number of Jews who believe, for example, in the use of bells on Shabbat, which is considered to be absolutely a desecration of Shabbat by other Jews. And therefore, he appealed, he petitioned, and was granted the right to create a separatist community that was comprised entirely of Jews who wanted to observe the halakha. This strategy of retreat, of strategic retreat, was emulated throughout the next few centuries as a way to maintain the standards of orthodoxy within an environment that really encouraged assimilation to the outside world. So if we kind of summarize these things, we see that in the 18th and 19th century, there's some tremendous change going on in the Jewish world. We see the growth of the Hasidic movement, which is essentially the first modern Jewish reform movement, which was a great challenge to the status quo in Eastern Europe. We see, as we talked about very briefly today, the rise of the Haskalah and its challenge to the traditionalist authorities. And we also see the rise of neo-traditionalism, which is in many ways a reaction to reform just as much as neo-orthodoxy is. So people like the Chatam Sofer, one might even say the Vilna Gaon, and others felt that, okay, the only way to really defend against these modern challenges is to create new boundaries that perhaps did not exist in the 16th and 15th century, but create these new boundaries in order to ensure the integrity of the Jewish people. All of these things come together with the decline in the coercive authority of the Kehillah, that is, the central governing body of the Jewish self-government loses much of its authority under the pressure of the new nationalist movements, like in France, which essentially did away with it because they had one court system, not a secular one and a Jewish one. And it allowed for the rise among Jews of voluntary affiliation, meaning for the first time, Jews could actually opt out of the traditionalist community without suffering really dire consequences because the Beit Din no longer had that same coercive authority. On the one hand, there's a positive element to this because it allowed for a great amount of intellectual and spiritual freedom. Jews could identify themselves, for example, as Hasidim, or they could identify themselves as Reform Jews, all kinds of different ways of expressing themselves religiously. But the negative side of it is rampant assimilation, because many Jews simply said, well, you know, why should I identify with being Jewish at all? And sometimes many of these movements were really stepping stones towards that end, as we see, for example, with Moses Mendelssohn. So that's the Haskalah in a nutshell. There's a lot more to say about this. I hope you watch some of the longer lectures, and I hope you found this lecture useful. Thanks very much.